Fire all of them just to be sure. I work in the customer service center of a major theme park. My coworkers and I only deal with problems related to our particular park, and not any other parks or properties owned by our company. I get a call. You've reached the theme park customer service center. My name is OP. How can I help you today?
You need to fire John.
Excuse me?
John, you need to fire him right now.
I'm sorry your experience with us was not what you were expecting. Could you tell me a little bit more about the problem you're having?
John was rude to me. I demand you fire him.
I'm afraid I'll need a little more information before I can help you, ma'am.
John! John! He was rude to me. Fire him.
I feel like I probably shouldn't humor her by checking our employee database, but I do anyway. Ma'am, there are 27 employees of our park with that name. I'm not sure which John would have been giving you a problem.
It wasn't your park, you idiot. It was in the restaurant.
Which restaurant?
The restaurant. The one on street.
The street she names is several blocks from the edge of our company's property. Wait a moment. You're calling the theme park service line to complain about an employee of some other business?
Your company owns the whole state. Everyone knows that. Now you need to fire that rude boy.
Our company does not own that restaurant, ma'am. I suggest you speak to the manager of that restaurant because there's nothing I can do for you.
Listen to me, you key pushing nitwit. Do you have any idea how much I spent on my your company vacation? 5-digit amount. Everyone knows that if you spend less than what she claims to have spent, then you're entitled to a superior level of service. John was rude to me and he must get what he deserves.
I'm afraid I can't help you with that.
Then let me speak to your boss. I'll have him fire John and you too. Or else I'll just take my amount of money she claims to have spent to rival theme park company instead.
I'll be happy to transfer you to my supervisor, although he's currently in a meeting with the head of our division and it might be several minutes before he can take your call.
No, that is not acceptable. I spent amount on my vacation. You go tell your boss he's gonna lose my business. I'll get him fired too.
If you continue to threaten our employees, ma'am, I'm going to disconnect this call.
Why are you protecting John anyway, huh? Is he your boyfriend or something?
What?
It all makes sense now. Trash boys always date trash girls.
The company is grateful for your business and hopes your experience with us was truly magical. That night in our break room, I overhear this conversation between two of my coworkers.
Then I got this angry lady on the phone demanding to speak to John's girlfriend. She just screamed gibberish at me for like 3 minutes straight. Wait a minute, you got her too? I spent amount on my vacation and you need to fire John and his trash girlfriend. That's her, dude. I hung up on her like after 2 minutes. She kept saying we were conspiring to protect these trash people and threatening to get me fired.
I guess the phrase first available representative is lost on some people. Off the clock gets you off the job. I work at a well-known superstore. I'm about midway through my shift when my supervisor tells me I'm good to take my lunch break. I've just finished paying for my food from our in-store sandwich shop when she pulls me aside.
Hey, can you help that customer outside to her car?
And they point to an elderly lady. I can't, I'm off the clock, miss.
It'll take you 5 minutes tops. Go help her.
I'm not gonna work off the clock. You can ask someone else to assist her.
No, I want you to assist her. You don't pull your weight around here anyway.
And I'm not going to break the law just because you can't find someone else.
Fine, you win.
She pulls out a clipboard.
But before you go to the break room, I want you to sign this. I'm sick and tired of you not listening to me.
I realize at this point she's writing me up for not working off the clock. No, I'm not signing that unless store manager is present.
If you don't sign it, you're fired.
You know what? Given the circumstances, I dare you to fire me. I'd love to see that get upheld after I tell him that you fired me for effectively refusing to break federal labor laws. Incredibly, she fired me on the spot for what she called insubordination. Needless to say, when we met with the store manager to discuss my termination, he wasn't very happy with my supervisor's actions when I told him what really happened. After he confirmed it through security footage, the store manager reversed my firing and put my supervisor on a 2-week unpaid suspension. While my supervisor was away, an investigation revealed that she'd previously pulled similar stunts on my coworkers and only got away with it because they didn't stand up to her like I did. She was fired less than 2 days after she returned for repeatedly and intentionally violating labor laws. I still work there, and now there are big posters by each time clock stating that working off the clock will not be tolerated. The scariest part of the movie is right next to you. I'm going to see Insidious: The Last Key. I purposely plan to go in the middle of the weekday a few weeks after it's open so I can avoid dealing with obnoxious teenagers. When I buy my ticket, I'm so far the only one seeing the film. I get some popcorn, wander into the theater, and take my seat. A while later, right as the final preview is finished and the movie is about to start, one other person walks in, a man who looks to be in his 50s. Out of 100 or so empty seats, he sits literally right next to me. I'm a little annoyed, as the theater has assigned seating, so he purposefully chose to sit directly next to the only other person in there. But I don't want to say anything. I figure maybe he just frightens easily, so he wanted to be near someone else or something. Still, it's making me a tiny bit uncomfortable. About 10 minutes into the movie, I start to very quietly munch on a few pieces of my popcorn, and every time I take a bite, he lets out a soft, annoyed sigh, just loud enough for me to hear, like he's angry I'm eating popcorn I bought. About another 10 minutes later, I slightly shuffle myself into my seat to get more comfortable, and again, very quietly, which results in him letting out a more pronounced, annoyed sigh. Finally, a while later, I lightly jolt when a jump scare happens in the movie. The man stomps his feet down, stands up, turns to me, and bellows, "Are you freaking kidding me? I came to see a movie, not listen to some kid who can't control himself. Where the frick is your mother?" I literally don't know how to respond, so I don't say anything, and I stare at him, dumbfounded. He stomps out of the theater and returns with the manager a few minutes later, ranting and raving about how much of a distraction I am, and demanding I be kicked out. At this point, I should mention that I'm a regular at the theater, and I'm quite friendly with the staff, so the manager immediately recognizes me. "Sir, I'm sorry, but he's a regular, and I've never had an issue with him."
"Why do you let kids into horror movies? They can't behave themselves."
"I'm 32, dude."
"Ugh, but, he's eating popcorn."
"Yes, sir. There's no rule stating you can't eat popcorn."
"He's moving constantly and jumping around like a lunatic."
The manager turns to me, slightly amused. "Have you been moving a lot?" "I mean, I kind of jumped at one of the jump scares." The manager turns back to the man. "Sir, it's a horror movie. I'm not going to kick someone out for jumping at one of the jump scares."
"It's unacceptable."
I'm royally peeved. "If you can't deal with any noise, why the heck did you choose to sit next to the only other person in the theater?"
"I don't have to answer any of your questions. I want this piece of crap out now."
"Sir, you need to calm down. Do not swear at the other guests."
"I want him out now, you bench."
The manager disappeared while the man literally stood over me smiling like he thought he'd won. A minute later, the manager arrived with security, and I was treated to seeing the man get kicked out of the theater without a refund, screaming the entire time. At that point, I was too rattled and angry to stay. I ended up switching out my tickets and seeing the next showtime a few hours later. The manager attempted to give me a bunch of free passes, but I felt bad and said no, since it wasn't the theater's fault. It blows my mind how crazy some people are. Well, that's a new one for the books. I'm a part-time bookseller at a local book chain. I've been working part-time for almost 7 years at the store, so I've heard it all, but this is the first time I've ever encountered this kind of stupid. We were told recently that we cannot leave our zones to help customers. Instead, we should direct them to a customer service rep, a customer who's about 18 or 19 walks up to the register where I am.
"Hello."
"Hi there, how can I help you?" I notice she doesn't have anything in her hands, and I think she wants a gift card, which happens a lot.
"So, this is my first time here?"
"Awesome, welcome in. Are you looking for anything in particular, or a certain book?"
"So, do I just pick it out and then bring it back?"
Sorry, what?
"Like, do I pick out what I want and you tell me when to bring it back?"
"We're a bookstore."
"Yeah, so when do I bring these back?"
I think that maybe she's high. "Yeah, this is a bookstore. You purchase items here. Every item has a barcode, which I scan up here, and then you give me something of a monetary value to take home and keep. This isn't a library."
"Oh, I thought you were going out of business, so I thought I should get something free."
"I assure you that we aren't going out of business, ma'am. Now, do you need help finding anything?" The customer stomps her foot.
"Why are your lights on if I can't get free things?"
She then turned and stomped out of the store. 12 Angry Tacos. I'm working at the drive-thru. "Thank you for choosing fast food, Jane. What can I get you?"
"Thanks, I have a question to ask you."
"Sure, go ahead and ask me."
"How many tacos come in a 12-pack?
"I'm sorry?"
"How many tacos come in a 12-pack?
"You just said it comes with 12.
"Are you serious?"
"Yes, ma'am, it comes with 12. A 12-pack comes with 12.
"I want to speak to your manager."
"I'm sorry, ma'am, what seems to be the problem?"
"Yes, I asked what comes in a 12-pack, and he keeps saying I'm saying it."
Ma'am, you are just saying it. It comes with 12. Are you even listening to yourself right now? The customer drove off in anger. About an hour or two later, we got a call about some complaint from a lady who wasn't getting service that she wanted at the drive-thru. The hour turned dour. I work at a call center. One day, I get a call from a customer who's very annoyed. I forget the exact reason why. When dealing with complaints, we have to try everything we can to resolve it before it can be passed to a complaints manager. It should be noted that my pay is not in any way affected if a customer decides not to do business with us. After handling this complaint for an hour, "Well, customer, I've done everything I can do for you, so I'm afraid your complaint will need to be escalated to a manager. Now, I'm afraid they won't take the complaint without speaking to you directly to verify I've done everything I can, and their wait time is almost an hour long. If you like, I can call you back once I have a manager on the line and save you waiting on hold."
"Yeah, you better. It would be ridiculous to expect me to wait another hour just for that."
"I understand, sir. Can I just confirm what's the best number to reach you at?"
"It's number, and you better call me back. I pay you a lot of money, and if I'm not satisfied, I'm leaving you and taking my business elsewhere."
"I understand, sir. I'll call the manager now."
"Yeah, you're scared now."
I'm stunned.
"As soon as someone threatens to stop the money, you lot bend over backwards to get it done."
"Sir, that's not accurate at all."
"But you just said it was an hour wait to get a hold of a manager, and now that I've mentioned money, you're telling me you're gonna call him now? You're fraudsters. It's all about the money for you."
I'm fed up now. "Sir, the wait time is an hour. I was simply notifying you that I was gonna disconnect the call with you and enter into the call queue for our complaints managers. I'm gonna sit on the phone for an hour listening to our repetitive hold music so you don't have to. I'm doing this to be considerate as you've already spent an hour on the phone with me and I wanted to save you on your phone bill." The customer pauses.
Okay, so, I'll hear from you in an hour?"
"Absolutely. Speak to you soon." Redial denial. Part of my job involves being issued a company mobile phone. I get a different one every day. As such, they're not specific to any one employee. The vast majority of the time, we use mobile to call our warehouse for manager support. We almost never receive calls. One day, the phone rings. "Company delivery. OP speaking."
"John?"
"No, sorry, this is OP. I'm a delivery driver for company."
"Oh, okay."
10 seconds later, the phone rings. "Company delivery. OP speaking."
"John?"
"Sorry, mate, still me."
"Right, okay."
10 seconds later, the phone rings. Same number. "Still me, mate."
"Not John?"
"Nope, still OP."
"Okay."
As you can imagine, 10 seconds later, he calls again. Mate, are you just using redial?"
"Yes. John?"
"If you hit redial, it will keep calling me."
"Oh, okay, I gotcha."
Once again, he calls me back. "Mate, do you know how phones work? You can't keep calling the same number expecting someone else to answer."
"No, John?"
No. "If you keep calling the same number, you will keep getting me."
"Oh, okay."
As you might expect, he calls again. "John?"
"John!
John!
Yes, John! Finally, I keep getting some twat from rival company."
"No, still me from company."
"Look, I'm getting a bit sick of this. Stop answering. Let me talk to John."
"Okay, mate. This is a mobile owned and operated by company. There is no John here. There's no John in my department. You are calling the wrong number."
"Fine, I guess I'll do it the hard way and dial each number again."
Thankfully, after that, he never called again. I just hope he got the number right that time and some other poor person didn't have the same experience. An improvement on Homer Simpson's makeup again. When I had to bring collision-damaged cars into my shop, many times the steering wheel airbag had been deployed. The bag would get caught up in your arms or the car's equipment when you tried to drive the car, so it was easier to just cut the bag off the wheel with a knife. My hands and clothing were usually covered with paint and colored dust, and I had to be careful not to get it on the inside of people's cars. So, when I noticed some strange colors on one of the airbags, I became concerned. As I laid the airbag flat to inspect it, I saw the complete impression of a woman's face on the airbag. All of her makeup had been transferred to the bag when it deployed. So I cut out the section with her face on it, framed it, and hung it on the wall of my office. Over time, I collected about 5 or 6 on my wall. When I asked my customers what they thought the pictures really were, everyone thought it was some sort of new concept art, but boy did they laugh when I told them what they were looking at.
Flee! you fools.
I'm alone in the shop one day when one of the manager's regular clients comes in and literally throws her chihuahua at me over the desk.
Bobby has fleas!
Bobby always has fleas, ma'am. You'll have to have your house treated.
Give him a flea bath, that'll be good enough.
He's just gonna get fleas again when you bring him home.
Give him a flea treatment, then they'll leave him alone.
They can still get on him when he has a treatment, they'll just die when they bite him. It doesn't magically make fleas disappear from your house.
Just give him a bath, I have to go.
You still have to fill out the paperwork, ma'am. This was a regular occurrence. I just feel bad for Bobby. Putting his foot in his caffeinated mouth. We give out complimentary coffee in our store. It's a big inside joke amongst the employees about how people just come in because there's free coffee, even though it tastes horrible.
Excuse me, miss, you're out of coffee.
Okay, I'll have someone make some more. Less than a minute later.
You didn't make any coffee yet?
I can't make it personally, sir. I have to stay at the desk. Someone is coming to make it. They'll be down in a few minutes.
Well, you know, I only come in here for the free coffee.
That's nice.
So, are you gonna make more coffee? I only come here for the coffee.
Later on, I say to a coworker, why are people so obsessed with that coffee? I'd rather die of thirst than drink coffee that tastes like it's made of feet. My coworker could only laugh helplessly as we watched the customer happily drink his feet coffee. Printing his own settlement. I'm employed as a technical engineer, which, in my company, means building components on the computer and sending the instructions to an automated machine in the next building, and occasionally walking between the office and machine shop to check the progress and make adjustments as needed. I have 20 years of experience and I'm basically at the top of my pay scale. Due to the amount of automation my job now entails, I've gained some downtime in the day. Not liking to be idle, I tend to fill the time. I'll refill the coffee, top up printers with paper, and do general IT support, and I've started training a few of the apprentices. None of these are official responsibilities, but it beats sitting on my hands. My husband and I, both men, decide to take a long holiday. I book the time off in advance, schedule some upcoming tasks on the machines to run without me, divert my emails to one of the other engineers, and set my work phone to divert to the main switchboard and set off on holiday. It's important to note that while my work has my personal phone number, I have explained that this will be turned off as we'll be traveling across Norway and will be pretty much out of contact. Just over a week into the holiday, we book into a hotel and are told by the receptionist that there have been multiple messages asking for me to turn on my mobile. This is strange, as I didn't share our itinerary with anyone apart from my husband's sister. I turn on my phone and it instantly starts lighting up with missed calls, texts, and voicemails. My boss is getting progressively angrier and more aggressive, asking me to call back but never explaining the urgency. Thinking there must be some kind of emergency, I call my work. My boss explodes down the phone at me, demanding that I return from holiday, accusing me of sabotaging the company, threatening legal action. I finally get him to calm down enough to work out the problem. The printer has stopped printing. A bit of troubleshooting later, and it turns out that the printer has run out of paper. I talk him through refilling the machine, and he's all happy again. Fast forward a week, and I'm called into a meeting with my boss. He lays out how completely unprofessional I am to cripple the company like that, and I'm told that I'm being fired effective immediately. I take him to tribunal for unfair dismissal, and at the mediation stage between his lawyers, the union lawyers, I come prepared. As well as over 60 texts, 40 phone calls, and 30 voicemails, he has called every hotel in the towns he knew we would be visiting. The union lawyers are claiming harassment, stalking, and unfair dismissal based on sexuality. His lawyers are obviously a bit shocked by this, so I play them one of the voicemails, where my former boss screams down the phone,
"You will regret this. This is what I get for hiring you, you frickin' gay slur. Just wait, you're dead. Dead!"
His lawyers pale, and in the end I walk away with a settlement for more than 2 years' wages. I walk into a new job a month later after finishing a second holiday to some parts of Norway we wanted to see previously. Thank you all for listening, and have a great day.